And now, live from the Ring of Fire, Mike Papantonio.
One thing you talk about, and I want to do this with you, one thing they used to do with Will Rogers is they'd talk about a lot of different things. That's what I want to do with you today.
Let's do it.
Let's start off with jobs and the economy. What's your thought?
Well, I think no matter how you shift around the monies, as far as tax breaks or whatever you're going to do, when the dust clears from all that, you still have a lack of jobs in this country. Because the fact is, they have gone away. They've gone away to countries where you can work people until they fall over for whatever paltry wage you can inflict upon them. And so when you see that they're trying to open up child labor, loosen up the Fair Labor Standards Act of, 1938 or 39 in Missouri, trying to make it legal for kids to basically get out of school by eighth grade and enter the workforce where they'll be frozen in that young mindset with no education, and they'll go get their hands crushed in a new stamping factory. But that being the case, you're still going to have massive unemployment in this country until the jobs come back, until you create industry in this country, until these massive corporations become patriotic, finally, and bring the jobs back. It doesn't matter how you shift monies around, you still don't have the jobs. That's the main problem.
One way that you have a multi-conglomerate create a slave society here is you do what they're doing in Wisconsin, Ohio, Indiana, all over the country, state by state, is they're demolishing the notion of labor laws and labor unions, aren't they?
Right. And when you see people protesting against those who are standing up for collective bargaining rights, what these people don't always understand is because of unions, you have a 40-hour work week and not a 60-hour work week. You have a weekend and not, you know, a few hours for church on Sunday and then back to the machine. It's unions that stood up and got their skulls cracked open, you know, by the cops and the hired thugs to stand up for rights that we take for granted now. That was unions doing that in the last century and the century before. And so it's because of these great and brave people that we enjoy the sanity and civility we do in the workplace now. And when you see these big, powerful groups wanting to get rid of that, you know, you can sum up in a few words. You know, that they obviously don't like their fellow Americans, and they want them to be subservient, and I guess on a state of almost constant starvation and job insecurity. Why you'd want to treat someone like that, I don't understand.
Okay, so we are still a strong nation. We have the finest factories in the world. We have great industry. But it's almost as if it's not just the American corporation. It's the multi-conglomerate still doesn't want to do business here. You know, we've always been able to say we're American-born citizens. We can get things done. We do get things done.
Yes.
But they still are ignoring the fact of what we have here. And there's a reason for that, isn't there?
Sure. Again, you can make so much more money by paying people such a bad wage in other countries in the world. So you just take your mass production elsewhere. And a lot of the countries that this work gets done in, I go to every year. You know, I go to China, Vietnam, Cambodia, places like that, Thailand, where a lot of these, you know, places like The Gap and Levi's have all ended up. And I don't exactly know what the inside of these buildings look like. But these people are not getting paid what you'd have to pay an American to make Levi's or whatever the product is. And you'd have to pay them a wage that an American can keep a mortgage going with. And to not want to do that, I don't get it. I just don't understand how much money one really needs.
Henry,
that is really it. Again, there still won't be any jobs or enough jobs here until these people bring them back.
Henry, really, you're one of the most widely traveled guest I've interviewed probably ever. And as you watch what's happened, we start off with the premise that the internationalist, the new internationalist, the new multi-conglomerate doesn't really have a country. They don't live in Japan, Dubai, Germany, Switzerland, the United States. They simply go around. It's almost like that corporation in Avatar. They
exactly.
Show up and they extract.
Yeah, and they kind of hover in the sky and via the internet. And their holdings are elsewhere, you know, Cayman Islands, who knows where.
Yeah.
And it's like cyber money, and there's cyber offices, and they basically just drop out of the sky to manipulate and soften economies, insert, you know, the thug tyrant government that gives them what they need. You know, Naomi Klein's book, the shock doctrine lays it out very, very well.
Right.
And but there's nothing new about this. You know, the British, the Dutch, the Belgians, the French went all over the world, you know, manipulating economies, softening them, and basically taking natural resources from people.
Do you see an attitude?
America too.
Do you see an attitude, Henry, in the U.S. that, by God, it could never happen here? I mean, like we have this notion that. Of course it can't happen here. You know, that would how do we become a victim of this type of internationalism? How does this happen to us? How do we become a victim of globalization?
Because capitalists, really, there's no real rules. You know, and I don't mind capitalism if it's regulated. I don't mind corporations if they do pay their fair share and play by some rules that don't pollute the system, you know, that don't pollute the environment and kill the workers off. I don't have a problem with any of that as long as they follow the rules. They have nothing but the most glaring contempt for the rules, and they seem to have nothing but snarling contempt for Americans. And that's the problem you have. They see us as just another bunch of rubes to tap. And that's it. We're just another group of suckers. And they're playing America. American companies or these internationalists are playing America like they've been playing India and all these other places for years. Now it's our turn.
Okay, education, you've written a lot about it. You say, look, you create a two-tiered system between the haves and the have-nots, and the end game to that is it's all good for really ugly, ugly side of capitalism.
Well, think about the short result of a profound lack of education in this country. You have a country that would skew more towards war. Because they're ignorant about the world. So when you say this country doesn't like your freedom, well, then let's go get them. That would be a logical response. Also, since the prison industrial complex is a multi-billion-dollar industry, when Johnny doesn't have an education, robbing a liquor store or doing some kind of criminal activity becomes more of an option. And I'm not defending crime. I'm just saying that's kind of what you go for. I got an education, therefore... robbing a liquor store probably isn't going to equate to me as what I'm going to do this weekend because I have an option thanks to a modicum of education. And so what you get is a lot of crime and a lot of potential wars, you get the cannon fodder for the future wars. And every single time we install more members of our military in yet another country or keep selling arms to a country like Egypt, which we've been doing for years, with the money we give them as a supplemental, they turn it right around and they buy our weapons. You almost ensure future conflict. It's the investment in our war economy.
And
the short and long of it.
You see education
under
attack.
You can say anything you want, but that really is it at the end.
Right. What about Wisconsin? What about Ohio? It's not just the labor movement under attack. It's partially the education movement under attack, which education, as you've written about so many times, it is the ultimate equalizer.
Educate
a population.
Why they fear it. And that's why they fear the Internet, because, this kind of rapid outflow of information, they can't stand it. Education pulls people out of wretchedness. And when they finally stand up out of wretchedness, you can no longer knock them down. When you turn that light on, you can't turn it back off again. So they just want to make sure the light bulb is never screwed in. And that's why on right-wing media, all of a sudden teachers are bloodsuckers. They're leeches. They're awful, contemptible people. And a lot of teachers come to my shows. And I meet them all the time because I always say nice things about teachers. And the stories they give me are no doubt what people call in and tell you, that they're working many hours a day. They're dealing with kids who are being abused at home. They become like the third parent. You know, it's a hell of a thing to do to be a teacher. And to vilify them on the level that some of these people, your Rush Limbaughs, are doing, it just shows you their contempt not only for education and for teachers, but for the American Social Compact, the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, and the thing that does make America exceptional.
If you want to be exceptional, then
let's do it.
Yeah, I was telling Ed the other day that I interviewed an MBA, top of his class, top 1%, probably top 3. He could tell me about economics, he could tell me about business policy, but he thought that Sinclair Lewis was a Supreme Court judge. You see, and that's part of what's happening here. We the corporate America goes in and says we have to educate them to use a calculator. We want them to use a calculator. We want them to have some fundamental skills, but we don't want to get, we don't want to allow them to think, because when they think, then government has to be concerned, in corporate America, corporate internationalism has to be concerned about transparency, accountability, those types of things.
Absolutely.
Teachers want to teach that, but they can't, can they?
Imagine having an America that has an more educated populace by 20 or 30%. Do you think the Bush administration would have been able to foist that illegal war in Iraq on the American people? Do you think anyone would have stood by and watched CNN and other major news carriers trumpet this party line, which they did do? And I have a great deal of contempt for these news agencies who did not call it for what it was when they could have. And they didn't. And America went along with it, not because we're bad people, but because we're not given enough information, and we're not given aptitude as young people. We're not even given civics lessons. These people who are always waving the Constitution, it's funny, because they rarely seem to know much about it. And I'm one of those sorrowful people who actually drags the Constitution with him literally everywhere I go. For years, I travel with a copy of the Constitution. I read from it a little bit literally every day. And I'm just a student of it. And when you see these people talking about some hot-button amendment they think proves something, and when you really get them on the hard points of it, they don't know a damn thing. And this should all be for rote by 10th grade.
Well, I got to tell you something. You touched on the media. We have a media that, while we have so many things happen in this country that are just disastrous, we have them focusing on Donald Trump and the birther saga.
Yeah.
Okay, still. Now, and why is that? Because the media drives ideas in this country. And you have a typical reporter that doesn't have, they simply don't have the foundation to even understand what the hell's happening to them, do they?
And they also, I think a lot of journalists now know that they're not going to get any backup when they walk in with a real story. Like the stuff that you and Bobby Kennedy do all the time. If you try and walk that into a major news outlet, I think these guys are going to be told to pack up the things on their desk and move out. So I think a lot of journalists already know that they're going to get no traction when they walk in with something that's not some idiotic distraction like Donald Trump, who's just a clown. And this whole birther thing is keeping us away from real issues that every American should have right on their desk every morning.
I got to tell you something. I look at your schedule. It's like Ed Schultz's schedule. Ed is always out there doing great work for everybody. I look at your schedule. It's the same deal. Same deal. A Vanity Fair understands that what you have to say really does matter. When I called you the Will Rogers of present day, I really didn't mean that. I mean, anybody who looks at your stuff, reads your stuff, and understands it is just got to be hugely impressed by it. Tomorrow, don't you start off with a series with National Geographic?
Yeah, I've been working with Nat Geo for quite a while now, and we're hard at work doing a lot of documentary work on animals. And the first one of these comes out tomorrow on Nat Geo Wild channel.
Well,
it's about snakes and American snake enthusiasts.
Well, they chose you. Virtually, the things we've been talking about here all along are things that you're not just talking in a vacuum. You have traveled almost to every corner of this world, comparing what's happening in the United States to what has happened to some of these countries that have fallen victim to this concept of internationalism.
Yeah, I mean, since the last time you and I spoke, I've been to North Korea, which was surreal, Mongolia, Bhutan, I was in Tibet, I was in Nepal, back to another trip to Vietnam, and very recently I was in southern Sudan and northern Uganda for about 3 weeks.
So now you've moved so many ways that are always consistent with trying to talk about great ideas. One thing you're doing right now is, again, people ought to follow Vanity Fair. They ought to follow your regular column in there to get an idea of exactly what you are thinking about, because it's things that we should all be thinking about. I want to ask you, we left off with ideas of kind of what's kicking around out there. One thing that I've seen your writing on is on the right wing's embrace of family values during a time of Vitter, Craig, Sanford, Foley, Ensign, Ted Haggard. Good God, how do they even have anything to talk about?
Well, that's the part they just avoid. And for them, it's all just propaganda talking points. You know, they want to control women's ovaries and subjugate people to their Old Testament theory. And I think that's all that it is, because they are hypocrites left, right, and center. And when you point out these things, they just kind of look the other way.
It's a vote and fundraising issue, isn't it?
Exactly. Like, put it this way. If every homosexual person in this country went under a rock and said, we'll never try and get married, and if every single woman said, you know what, I'll never get an abortion, they would lose two major fundraisers. And so the last thing these people want is for...
Henry Rollins, we need you more than ever right now. Sorry we're out of time, my friend. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.